people who are out there trying to figure out where to go. So what we've been doing is looking at issues, and one of the issues that we passed on is actually one of the issues that's being dealt with today by appropriations, and it was the need for Denise, can't remember her last name, she's a Calais Select Board member, testified to us that home care providers were a community that we wouldn't think of as a community at risk, but they really were, because they're having people in their homes, some of whom are positive and some of them are, they're in the same situation as families with children. Normally, though, a lot of those people go to adult day programs and for some respite, and they're not allowed to do that. So these home providers are really in a pickle. And so one of the things that we suggested to appropriations was that they get an additional pay bonus, just like foster families are getting additional pay because of the children that have to be staying home now all the time, and it's requiring more care. So that is one of the things they're dealing with today. And I think what they're doing is suggesting adding, it's not a huge amount, but it's $1,000. Is it $1,000 a month for the 3 months?
Yes.
For people who, so it'll be a little bit more. It isn't certainly a lot, and it isn't as much as we're providing to the foster families, but it does give them a little bit of incentive. So that was a long way of saying that I think that there are other issues out there, and we need to hear what those issues are that are confronting people that may not clearly have a place that they feel they can go, or it isn't clear where that issue should reside. And so let me see who we have with us today. We have Eitan. I'm gonna go up here for a minute and look at my participant list. We have Diana Wally from Brattleboro, who's Community Equity Collaborative. Tom Donahue, there you are, speaking for the, I haven't seen you for a long time, speaking for the CAP agencies, I believe.
Absolutely.
Okay. And Eitan, and I'm not even going to pronounce your last name, but Eitan, do you want to pronounce it for us?
Sredin Longo. Yeah, I know.
I know.
I know. It's slightly demonic. Nasreddin Longo, sure. Eitan is fine. My mother never uses the last name.
Okay. Eitan and I were old gym buddies from quite some time ago, but
and we live about a mile apart.
Yes. And Eitan is also the chair of the what is the exact name of it?
Well, formally the advisory panel on racial disparities in criminal and juvenile justice systems.
Right, that one.
Right.
Thank you. And we have Jessica Brown. And who, Jessica, who are you with us?
Hi, I am on the panel that of which Eitan is the chair, but I'm also the supervising attorney for the Public Defender Office for Chittenden County. So,
okay, great, great. And do we have Mark Hughes? Is he here? You are?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. I can only see a few people at a time. And is Karen Lafayette with us? Okay.
See Karen on there.
I am with you.
Great. And Kate Lapp from VPIRG? I see we have Mark Anderson. And Susanna Davis. Okay. Does that about do it? Okay, so what I'd like to do is
sorry, Jeanette, are we missing AARP Greg?
No, I didn't see his name, but I see
Greg is here.
Hi, everyone. I'm here.
Okay. Right. I saw him, but I didn't see his name on the participant list, but there you are. So I guess what I'd like to do is just start throwing out issues that are have bubbled to the surface that are being faced by the communities you represent or have dealings with or hear about or anything else. And so, Eitan, do you want to start?
Sure. as part of my duties in being the chair of the RDAP is to check in with people that I know who are community stakeholders around the state who are not necessarily on the panel. Of course, that's going to be a lot of people. In the course of that, over the past pretty much month or so, it's become very clear to me that the great alliance and liaison between communities of color and poor whites, which is something we're not supposed to speak about in the United States, is very much evident. Because what I'm hearing from people in communities of color and what I'm hearing from poor people in the state who are Caucasian is very similar. It has to do with the unemployment system, and I really won't take a whole lot of time, mostly because at the moment, I mean, as you all have known, the situation in this pandemic changes about every 10 minutes.